You raised the example of the plate glass window as being symbolic of a boundary, but when so often that's used by architects, I think, as an aspiration to being a border.
I know.
But that's very much about a visual aspiration when the practicality is against that. To what extent are we being delusional?
You are being delusional.
If you think about what happens with plate glass, I mean, this is a bit noir of mine, fixed plate glass. The delusion is this: you get visual transparency, right? Not only do you screen out people transgressing the space, very hard to walk through a plate glass window, or although given a certain amount of vodka, it is possible to try, but you're screening out smell, sound, right? It's desensitizing. It privileges the notion of looking inside, but screens out other kinds of senses, which are more interactive. And you know, when Louis Sullivan first began using plate glass, his notion was that plate glass would always turn on an axis. And he experimented a lot with that in the Chicago buildings. So you could take these, he used 6 foot wide plate glass windows. They had these little axis pins in them. You could always open them, even up to 13 stories, which is the highest he ever got with them, which is the tower in Symphony Hall in Chicago. But his notion was a window should always open. Well, that's a technological challenge for us. If you were Renzo building the Shard, how would you open a window at, I don't know how many stories this palace is going to be, 60, 72. But there must be a way to solve it. And the lower you get down, you know, as the vector gets closer to the ground, the more urgent it seems to me to solve it. It's really it's a challenge about porosity. Right? And I think that it's a technological challenge as well. But we're not thinking about materials quite in those terms. I mean, the sealed glass block box has now had on a new lease in life in some versions of eco-friendly buildings, you know, with heat exchangers and so on, which require this absolute, you know, boundary condition, heat exchanger to work. So I think it's a big challenge for us as designers, how to find new techniques of making porosity. Anyhow, that's my view.
I'm interested when you're talking about the city. If you set aside for a moment things like gated communities, which you obviously are not porous, what is it that does or doesn't make the boundaries between all the borders between different bits of the city porous in your mind? I mean, if there isn't actually a physical fence right. that you can't get through.
I mean, I think one of the things we haven't really taken on board is creating borders through mixed function spaces. And I'll give you an example of this. My team at the LSC did a project about how, is it called blue, what's it called, blue water?
Blue water.
Yeah. Blue water. It's not a project I was involved in, but I'll give you a good example here about this. About how blue water could become not only a shopping mall, but a hospital, have government offices in it, how some of the parking lots could be, how you could remove cars and put in housing. And in a way, it's kind of reinventing the wheel. It's how do you make a high street out of a shopping mall. But the idea was to take a fixed function space, as most shopping malls are, and try and look at the ways that you create these border-like conditions by mixing in them lots of different kinds of activities for which they weren't meant. For me, this has been an issue practically about arguments about zoning. And very much like Jane Jacobs, I'm suspicious about overzoned places. And that includes overzoning through historic preservation. If you look at the ideal for something which is underzoned yet keeps its character, is a kind of light touch zoning that's practiced in Bologna. Also Parma's another good example of that. We always take our students there to see what this looks like. It isn't a free-for-all. You can't tear down a historic palace to put up a Walmart's. But within that, the notion is that within building shells, there should be much more give and take about what goes on in the buildings. And that modern buildings should be inserted into the midst of places that have so-called historical character to them, which is an argument about fabric. That fabric of this, you know, physical building fabric of this sort is not the same thing as a preservation of the character of a place, keeping the historic character of a place intact. That is, that you're able to see evolution, insertion, disruption, contradiction inserted within broad parameters into the historical fabric. That's a way of creating a border condition in terms of use. And I think that's, if we take that just a step farther, that's what I try and do in my book, we'd be clever about uses which bring in unlikely people into those spaces. In Blue Water, for instance, what this project was about is how to take, for instance, an AIDS clinic inside a space where nobody wanted to see people who have AIDS. How do you cite that without being in your face, yet make it clear that there are people who are there for different purposes than buying Gucci bags? And I think it's that kind of, for urbanists, that's that kind of experiment, which has to be very down to earth and practical rather than ideological, which gradually creates, the, in terms of usage, something that has this border membrane-like quality. I'm really sorry, I should leave you. I've got to do this other thing. Thank you very much for inviting me. I have to apologize for running, but maybe this is something in some other format, or if you do this again, that we can pursue more. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much.